Hi and welcome back to study room. Thank you so much for joining me here. I am Pratyaksha, your chemistry teacher, and today we'll be learning chapter 4 of chemistry, structure of the atom. Now in the previous chapter we had learned about atoms and molecules. In this lesson we'll be learning about the structure of atoms. We'll be learning what are the subatomic particles and what are the characteristics of the subatomic particles. So let's get started. Let's revise first. What are the fundamental building blocks of matter? If you may remember the previous lesson, we had learned that atoms, they are the fundamental building blocks of matter. And in a compound, in a pure compound, molecules are those entities that are able of independent existence. But what are the fundamental building blocks of matter? They are atoms. Are atoms really indivisible as proposed by Dalton? Or are there smaller constituents inside the atom? Now, this is what we'll be learning in this chapter. We'll be learning what is the structure of the atom, what are the subatomic particles, meaning what are the components of atom, what is atom made up of, all right? So we will be learning in this chapter where Dalton's postulates went wrong. Indications about atoms are not indivisible. One of the first indications that atoms are not indivisible comes from studying static electricity and the condition under which electricity is conducted by different substances. Now, there are some substances, that conduct electricity, and studying electricity by the conduction of those elements, we can determine that atoms, or the constituent, the smallest particles of matter, they are made up of further smaller components. And atoms, it can be then concluded that atoms are divisible, they are not indivisible. Okay, charged particles in matter. Now, in the previous chapter, if you may remember, we had learned about ions. We had learned about that some particles, they are positively charged, and we had learned about that some particles, they are negatively charged. So this learning of charged particles, they are very essential and they are very important when we have to learn about the subatomic particles. Many scientists contributed in revealing the presence of charged particles in an atom. So they found it proton, electron and neutron. They found that atom was composed of positively charged particle, that is your proton, negatively charged particle, that is your electron, and the neutral one, that means that entity which carried no charge at all, that was your neutron. Okay. So, in a stable atom, there are equal number of protons and equal number of electrons. That is why the atom is in a stable existence. Whereas, those atoms that are either positively charged or either negatively charged, they are not in a stable state, and therefore, they need either, an excess of electron, or, they need to lose some electrons in order to achieve that stable state. Comb dry hair, does the comb then attract small particles of paper? This is a brainstorming question, all right? Rub a glass rod with a silk cloth and bring the rod near an inflated balloon. Observe what happens. Where does this charge come from? Now, you may do this very simple experiment while combing your hair. Take some small pieces of paper, and then after you have combed your hair with your comb, you bring that comb to those small pieces of paper. You will observe that comb attracts those small pieces of paper like it is visible here in the diagram. Another interesting thing is when you rub a glass rod with a silk cloth and when you bring that rod near an inflated balloon, okay, that balloon that is filled with air, something interesting will happen. This is a small experiment that you can do it by your own. And then in this chapter, we'll be learning why this happens, okay. First of all, let's begin here by understanding the first subatomic particles, that is electron. Electrons, we know, are negatively charged. But who discovered electrons? Okay, J.J. Thomson in 1900, he was the first who discovered electron. It was known by 1900 that the atom was indivisible particle but contained at least one subatomic particle, that was the electron, and it is owing to J.J. Thomson and to his experiments that we discovered what an electron is. What he did in his experiment is that he took cathode and he took anode. Okay, these are charged electrodes. Okay, electrodes means they're capable of conducting electricity. So he connected cathode and he connected anode through an electrical source. Okay, and he, you know, he built a sort of setup that was air free, that was, you know, in a vacuum state. In a vacuum state, why? So that there is minimum interference of air while he's observing how the electric current behaves. Okay, so when he did that, he observed that some particles, they were traveling from cathode towards anode. Okay, and you know, when in that vacuum tube sort of setup, when they were made to fall on a fluorescent screen, okay, they diverged, they, you know, scattered into small places, all right, small bits of places. And when you put a fluorescent screen helps in when the small particles, they fall onto the fluorescent screen, that particle that shines. Okay, so fluorescent screen helps in determining whether there are some particles that are traveling from cathode to anode or not. So he did that and he observed that some particles have traveled from the negative cathode to the positive anode. Okay, now since there is the travel of some particles from the negative to the positive source, he concluded that these are electrons because they are negatively charged, and that is how he came to the conclusion that electrons are those subatomic particles. Who discovered proton? We know how J.J. Thomson discovered electron, but let's learn that who discovered proton. It was E. Goldstein. He was a German scientist in 1886, and he discovered the presence of new radiations in a gas discharge, and he called them canal rays. What he did was he made a setup. Okay, he took the help of cathode and anode, you know, and all those two electrodes that we saw in the previous setup of Thomson as well. Okay, and this time there was no vacuum in that tube sort of structure. There was air, and that air was present at a very low pressure. What you observe that when a high voltage generator, when electricity was applied through this high voltage generator, some particles, they traveled, the electrons, they traveled from cathode to anode, that we have already been established in the previous experiment. Okay, so what happened here is that when electrons they were traveling through this tube, discharge tube, okay, they collided with air particles. They collided with air particles, and they caused the ionization of air particles. Okay, what is ionization? Ionization is the process through which some stable particles, they are made either to lose some charge or either to gain some charge. So electrons, since they are negatively charged, okay, so when they collided with the air particles, they caused these air particles to become positively charged, all right. So, and how did he came to the conclusion that some positive charge sources are being, you know, produced in that discharge tube? He came to this conclusion when he saw that the cathode that he took was not a very solid cathode, it was perforated. What do we mean by perforated? We mean that there were some small gaps, some small holes in that cathode. Okay, he took that perforated cathode and he observed that small beams, they were traveling towards cathode. Okay, they were traveling towards cathode, they were traveling from, they seemed, they appeared to be coming from anode to cathode. As you can see this red arrow in this diagram over here, okay, You may fall under the assumption that these rays are coming from anode to cathode, but that's wrong. These positive charged particles are basically by the reaction of electrons that is happening in that discharge tube, and that electrons is causing those ionized charged particles of air to travel from the negative source to the positive source. Okay, so when this is when this happens. E. Goldstein, he observed that some rays were passing through this perforated cathode, and he called them the canal rays. So canal rays are the positively charged rays that Goldstein discovered. This subatomic particle had a charge, and it is equal in magnitude but opposite in sign to that of the electron. So electron is a negatively charged particle, and these canal rays or the protons, they are the positively charged particles. What about another comparison between electron and proton? That proton's mass was approximately 1830 times as that of the electron, and in general, electron is represented as E minus because it is negatively charged, and proton by P plus because it is positively charged. Okay, so proton's mass was approximately 1830 times as that of the electron. Okay, so electron's mass is not so much, but proton's mass is a lot. The mass of a proton is taken as one unit and is charged as plus one. The mass of an electron is considered to be negligible and is charged minus one. That means there is some mass, the proton carries some mass, and electron, it is almost negligible in mass. Okay, so the mass of one proton, it can be considered as one unit. Okay, whereas electron's mass, you can consider it as negligible, means it is very, very small in quantity as compared to that of proton. Okay, what are canal rays? We know that canal rays are those positively charged ionized gaseous particles that are traveling from anode to cathode. Okay, and who discovered this? This was discovered by Goldstein. Okay, and canal rays could be taken as opposite to cathode rays because it is positive in charge, because it is your proton and it carries more mass than that of an electron. If an atom contains one electron and one proton, will it carry any charge or not? Now we know that atom needs some stability, all right? So the number of electron and the number of proton in an atom should be equal. Then only it will be in the stable state, no? So if an atom contains only one electron and only one proton, it won't have any charge. Because the negatively charged negatively charged proton is being balanced by the positively charged proton, there is neither an excess of electron or there is neither an excess of proton. All right, so this means that this atom is in a stable state and it will not carry any charge because it is the number of electrons is equal to the number of protons. So this is this small part of this chapter. Now let's move on to the second part of the chapter, and here we'll be learning about the structure of an atom. We'll be learning this in two parts. In this part, we'll be learning part one, and we'll be getting to know that how the structure of an atom is being formulated and postulated by various scientists. So let's find out. Thomson's model of an atom. Thomson proposed the model of an atom to be similar to that of a Christmas pudding. Sorry, the electrons in a sphere of positive charge, like dry fruits in a spherical Christmas pudding. So what Thomson here is proposing is that a Christmas pudding is like it's like this structure, a small dry cake sort of structure in which dry fruits are visible. So you can imagine this to be like a small chocolate cookie ball, all right, small chocolate cookie, okay, in which the chocolate pieces are visible. Okay, if you want to understand how Thomson's model worked, or you can also imagine this to be like this Christmas pudding here in this diagram, where these small dry fruits are what Thomson called them as negative electrons, and the rest of the mass of this spherical body, the rest of the mass of this pudding is what he equated to the positively charged nucleus, the positively charged protons. So what Thomson he concluded was that protons, they are accumulated in a sort of mass, a homogeneous mass like structure. They are the positively charged one, and electrons, they are scattered here and there, okay, like small dry fruits or chocolate chips, like it is there in a cookie bowl or in a Christmas pudding, all right? So they are scattered like small beads, okay, and they are scattered in between the whole positive sphere of that proton. So Thomson proposed that an atom consists of a positively charged sphere and the electrons are embedded in it. Okay, they are scattered, they are embedded inside of that positive charge. And the negative and the positive charges are equal in magnitude. This we know. Why? Because the atom has to be electrically neutral so that it does not have an excess of charge or a deficiency of charge. Because the atom has to exist in a stable state, it has to have equal number of electrons and equal number of protons. Rutherford's model of an atom. Now we just saw Thomson's model of an atom. Let's move to Rutherford's model of an atom. Rutherford designed a rather elaborate experiment for how electrons are arranged within an atom. So Rutherford was in denial to what Thomson proposed, and he said that no, the distribution of electrons in an atom is it occurs in a very different way than what you are trying to propose. So he did an experiment, and the experiment setup is seen over here in this diagram. What he did was he took very fast moving alpha particles. Now these fast moving alpha particles were basically helium particles, okay, since they have a mass of 4u, so they are very fast moving and they have a considerable amount of energy. He took these helium ions, mind you, he took helium ions means they were charged. They had positive charge and they have this mass 4u. So 4u is a very, a very small amount of mass. Okay, it has a very small unit of mass. So he took these positively charged helium ions and he named them alpha particles. And he caused these alpha particles to strike a thin gold foil. And how was this thin gold foil existing? This thin gold foil was basically surrounded by a sort of screen, a circular fluorescent screen. Why fluorescent screen? If you may remember that Thomson's experiment, he took this fluorescent screen so that when particles they scatter and they fall onto the fluorescent screen, some fluorescent, some bright shiny lights could be observed. So when he did this so that that fine beam of alpha particles, this blue line over here, this fine beam of alpha particles could directly hit the thin gold foil. Okay, so what happens is that when it hits the thin gold foil, he observed that most of the alpha particles, they went straight through the gold foil. That means it passed straight through. Okay, some of the alpha particles, they deflected at some small minor angle. Okay, but what he observed, and this is a major thing over here, what he observed is that towards the center of this gold foil, some particles were deflected with a rather very large angle. Okay, deflected means they scattered here and there with a very tilted axis, and they did that with a very large angle. Okay, so let's see first of all, that why did he select a gold foil? He selected a gold foil because he wanted as thin a layer as possible, and the gold foil was about only 1,000 atoms thick. So we know that atoms are so small in size, 100 picometers if you may remember the previous chapter. They are so small in size, and he did not need a very thick size of a substance. He needed a very thin size, and since metals, they are malleable, gold was the only metal that could be malleable to around only 1,000 atoms thick layer. Okay, so that's the reason why he selected gold foil. As you can see in this diagram, this thin paper sheet like gold foil, this had only so much atoms. Okay, what did he expect from this experiment? It was expected that alpha particles, that is those charged helium ions, they would be deflected by the subatomic particles in the gold atoms. This is what he was trying to determine. What his agenda was that when those beam of alpha particles, they would strike this this gold foil, some particles would be scattered. And through this scattering, he wanted to take an estimation that how atoms are arranged. But he found a rather peculiar observation, found a rather interesting observation, was that since the alpha particles were much heavier than the protons, he did not expect to see large deflections, but this scattering experiment gave totally unexpected results. The following observations were made. Most of the fast moving alpha particles pass straight through the gold foil. This I explained you during that diagram, right? That most of the particles, they directly passed straight through the gold foil. Okay. some of the alpha particles, they were deflected by the coil by small angles. This I also explained you. Some they were deflected by a very small angle, say here, okay. But there were surprisingly one out of every 12,000 particles that appeared to rebound, okay. Now, what is this? What does this mean? They appear to rebound means they appear to deflect by very large angles, okay. They did not intersect, they did not intersect, but they appear to rebound, okay, by very large angles than what he had expected. As you can see in the small animation, expected results were that some passed through, all right, some passed through, some they got deflected by very small angles, so maybe here, maybe here, maybe here, okay. But some, they straight away got rebound, means they hit that gold foil, but they again, they again deflected by a very large angle and they had to trace their path back. What did Rutherford conclude from experiment? His conclusion was that the alpha particle scattering experiment, from this experiment he concluded that most of the space inside the atom is empty because most of the alpha particles pass through the gold foil without getting deflected. So that first postulate of Thomson, that there is a very homogeneous sort of a positive spherical body in the sense that that whole sphere has a positive charge, okay. Thomson's idea that there is a spherical positive charge, that was proven wrong, because most of the atoms, they directly pass straight through. So when they pass straight through, that from that he concluded that inside most of the atom is empty. That is why they pass straight through, they did not deflect. Second observation, that very few particles were deflected from their path, indicating that a positive charge of the atom occupies very little space. Okay, so very few particles, they were deflected from their path. That small deflection, if you may remember, indicating that the positive charge of the atom, they occupy very little space. And the third observation was, a very small fraction of alpha particles were deflected by 1800, indicating that all the positive charge and mass, positive charge plus mass of the gold atom were concentrated in a very small volume within the atom. Because it rebounded, if you may remember, right, it hit the surface and then it got rebounded. So from that he concluded that there must be a source of positive charge and some mass of the gold that were concentrated in a very small area. That is why only one out of 12,000 particles, only those few amount of particles, they were able to rebound. Do you know that the radius of the nucleus is about 10 to the power 5 times less than the radius of an atom? This is an interesting fact, right? So if an atom, if this is an atom, okay, and if this has a radius, atom is, we consider an atom to be an almost spherical body, okay? So spherical, circular, whatever you may want to call it. So if the radius of this atom, is whole 10 to the power minus 10 meter, okay, sorry, not the radius, the whole this dimension, okay, is 10 to the power minus 10 meter, then do you know that what area does the nucleus occupy? Nucleus is only 10 to the power minus 15. It is 10 to the power 5 times less than the radius of the atom. It is only 10 to the power minus 15. That is the smallest part that the nucleus, with Rutherford, just concluded. That is what he got to the estimated to. Features of an atom. Now Rutherford, from his experiment, he put forward a nuclear model of an atom which had the following features. There is a positively charged center, okay, so he knew that there is a positively charged center and some considerable mass that is almost towards the center of an atom, called the nucleus. This he called the nucleus, okay. Nearly all the mass of an atom resides in the nucleus. So positively charged plus the mass, these are the nucleons, okay, and this is what nucleus consists of. The electrons revolve around the nucleus in circular paths. So, and the size of the nucleus is very small as compared to the size of the atom. So yes, this we have established. That is why the rebounding was able to happen, because the size of the nucleus is very small. And because there is a large amount of positive charge, plus most of the mass is concentrated towards the nucleus. So what he concluded was the electrons, they must revolve around this nucleus in circular paths. Like this, exactly like this. If this is the nucleus, okay, that consists of protons plus the mass, electrons, they revolved in circular paths. So this could be a circular path again, this could be a circular path. So there could be a lot of circular paths, like you can see in the small animation over here. And this is what Rutherford proposed to be the model of an atom. But there are certain drawbacks of Rutherford's model of the atom. Let's have a look at them. The revolution of the electron in a circular orbit is not expected to be stable. Why? Because any particle in a circular orbit would undergo acceleration. Okay, so if you are supposed to, you know, move in a circular path, so you would, there would be some energy required to move into that circular path. So you would be in some state of speed, you would be in some state of acceleration. Okay, and when you are supposed to, say, travel a circular path, you would consume energy, you would be in a state of acceleration. And after, there would come a point when your energy would start to deteriorate, when your energy would start to be, exhaustible. And after that, there will come a point where you will ultimately just stop moving in the circular path. So this is what the basic drawback of Rutherford's model is that any particle in a circular orbit would undergo acceleration. And because of that, the charged particles would radiate energy. Okay. Thus, the revolving electron would lose energy and finally fall into the nucleus. So, if an electron has to keep on revolving and revolving around this, it would keep on losing energy because it would be in a state of acceleration. And there would come a point, as you can see in this animation, there would come a point when it would stop revolving and it would ultimately collapse. That is, it would ultimately meet this, come close to this nuclear state and fall. And when that would happen, if that were so, then the atom would be highly unstable, because there has to be some distance, right? There has to be some distance between the positive and the negative charges. If they come together, if they collapse and, you know, come together at one point, then matter that we know that would just cease to exist, right? So this is the drawback of Rutherford's model. So Thomson proposed a model, then Rutherford proposed a model, but there were some drawbacks to both of these models. So there must be some other structure, some other, model that was chosen if both of these were considered to be, rejected. So that we will find out in the next part of the chapter.